thanks everybody for coming, and sorry that there are not enough seats. So today I want to show you how to do deep learning for image classification. And maybe first, please hands up, who of you is a machine learner? Okay. Have you used deep learning? Okay, so maybe I start a bit from scratch. But that's good for you because you get a free 3-minute crash course in machine learning now. So let's consider this table. This is data from a hypothetical production machine. So we measure temperature, minimum, maximum, and vibration, and we aggregate. That means we take the minimum, the maximum. We also could take the average. And then we measure asperity. That's a measure of quality, how the part has been produced, if it's a good part or a bad part. So as you can see here, part number is not very interesting, but all the other fields are quite interesting for us. So part number we skip. And you see that we have three columns which we can use to predict the outcome. So the outcome is asperity. And that's all about machine learning and predictive analysis. So you have some data points or some columns in the table. You use those, you feed them into a model, you train, and then you get a model which can predict you the outcome. So now I have a question for you. Which of those three columns here do you think is the best one to predict asperity without any algorithm, just by looking at the data? Max vibration. It's pretty clear. And can someone of you tell me a simple rule in any programming language to do so? Excuse me? Yeah, there's a break-even point or a threshold. So what do you guess? What is a good threshold? 1,000 is maybe good. Other guesses? Anyway, 100 or 1,000, so this is a bit... Any Python programmers in here? Okay. Oh, not that many, no? Java programmers? Okay, are you still old school? So you see here, if max vibration is greater than 100, we just predict 1, and that means the part is broken. So under the hood, I've turned this example in a so-called classification example. So in machine learning, we distinguish between two main things what we do. If we predict a continuous value, we call it regression. And if we predict a discrete value, we call it classification. And since we have only two outcomes, we call it binary classification. Okay? And this is the way how to implement it if you know about the system, but we want to learn it. So that's why we call it machine learning. Any one of you has seen this formula? Okay, how is it called? Linear regression, exactly. So the idea is here you just have your input columns of the table, which is x1, x2, and x3, and then you learn the weights w0 to w3. And that's the Hello World supervised machine learning example, which is called linear regression. And by the way, supervised machine learning means I'm supervising the machine. I'm telling the machine, this is the outcome, please learn w0, w3. That's all about. So I think you have now understood the most essential parts of machine learning. How do we turn from a linear regression model to a classification model? So you see here we have a binary classification data. So it's really simple. There's a function called sigmoid. Don't be scared. If I want to scare you, I tell you it's 1 over 1 plus e to the power of minus t, but what it actually does is it takes a value range from minus infinity to plus infinity and squashes that value to a range between 0 and 1. And then you just select the threshold in the middle, and if it's below 0.5, you predict 0. If it's higher than 0.5, you predict 1. And you have turned a linear regression model into a binary classifier, and this is called logistic regression. So you have learned two machine learning models already in the first 4 minutes. So, and the cool thing is, if you understood those two things, you already understood the basis of neural networks. So the Hello World neural network is called a perceptron. And the perceptron is pretty old. I think IBM implemented that in the 70s already. you have also your input data x1 to xn, and as in linear regression, you assign weights, so you basically multiply. You define how much of this value do I want to have as influx, and then you take the sum, and there is also a so-called bias, so that's the offset, how high your function is on the graph. And the final, so this thing here is nothing else than linear regression. Okay, do you see that? And then you have a so-called activation function. In this perceptron case, it's a step function. In logistic regression, it's a so-called sigmoid function. And in neural networks, we are using all sorts of functions. And there is a rap song to remember this. It's called vector x times weight. Add a bias, activate. Okay, you just wrap this all over again, and then you can remember how a neuron looks like. So if you have understood how one single neuron is computed, it's relatively easy to understand the whole artificial neural network. So this computation I've just shown you is taking place for each and every neuron. You can see here we have the inputs, x, we compute. So we add the weights, we sum up, we activate, and then we send the output to all the other arrows downstream. And that we do for each and every neuron in each and every layer. So this is the most simple neural network because it has only one hidden layer, and that's for most of the cases already sufficient, because a single hidden layer neural network is a so-called universal function approximator. That means a single hidden layer neural network can represent any mathematical function. You just have to have enough data and enough compute power. Okay? Since we don't have enough data and don't have enough compute power, all the time there are some variations, but the essence is a single hidden layer neural network. And you basically can then do those things. You can do time series forecasting, so that's oil price prediction. It also works a bit for Bitcoin. I'm currently working on that. It's not perfect. We use it a lot in Watson IoT for anomaly detection, because the neural network can learn how normal data looks like, and it outperforms everything else we've ever tried. So this is an example where the neural network learns how normal data looks like, and whenever it sees something which it hasn't seen before, it gives you a spike, and that's, for example, an anomaly we introduced, and it was clearly detecting that spike among all the noise. So that's something we are currently trying out with our clients. Then there's another category of things you can do, that's natural language understanding. So this text has been generated by a neural network, and it looks like Shakespeare, because the neural network has been trained with Shakespeare. And that works with pretty much every type of sequence data. You can show the neural network the source code of the Linux C kernel, and it generates C code for you. Okay? Then this is a famous example in computer vision, one of the first things which got published. So you train a neural network with a real image, and then you use some art, and it generates a new image using your source image in the style of the artist. You see here, it's always the Golden Gate Bridge, and on the left-hand side is the original style of the artist. And the latest thing I've discovered is this one. It's a neural network which can generate 3D models of persons in real time from 2D video streams, which is quite impressive. So Donald Trump will like that for his automated killing drones. And see here that you have maybe seen in Terminator already. So that stuff is actually working. So I want you to understand this. It's relatively simple. So the idea behind that is image classification. And it's, in this case, a binary classifier. But I want to show you something different. So this is an open museum. It's an online museum. You can look at pictures from different art pieces from all over the world, and they tell you from where it comes. Now, this is, for example, something from Japan, and it has more than 22,000 of those images. And the idea is we just want to predict the country based on the image. So when it comes to image recognition, as I told you, a single hidden layer neural network is a universal function approximator. That means in theory, you can just use all the pixel values as an input. Then it's just a table with, 2 million input columns, and then it predicts the class. So that's this function here. But actually, it turns out we don't have enough data and compute power in order to train such a neural network. Therefore, in computer vision, we use a neural network type called CNNs, convolutional neural networks. I'll just show you what the convolution is. So convolution, mathematically, is just applying one function over another function. And the black line is the result of the convolution. Okay? And this idea is taken into neural networks for image recognition. So let's consider this to be an image, a grayscale image. A black and white image. So 0 stands for black and 1 for white. Of course, it's a very small image. And now you are convolving another image over it. And this other image is a filter. So this filter, this you will train. You basically just scan over the image, you apply the filter, and while you're applying the filter, you are adjusting it to get good results. At the end of the day, in each layer, you are training and learning those filters. So this is now a neural network for image classification. It's a multi-class classifier because there are 4 classes of images. And it turns out that it exactly looks like the visionary system in your brain. So from bottom to top, they have sampled what actually the neural network is seeing in this layer. And in the first layer, you see only circles, lines, and edges. Nothing concrete. And that's the same as in your brain. Okay? If you see my face, your first layer in your brain, your first layer of neurons, only recognizes circles, edges, and lines. There was a very cruel but famous example. They put a little electrode into a cat's brain, and they showed a line to the cat in a certain angle, and they spotted the particular neuron which fired when they have showed the line to the cat. So you see here it's relatively abstract, and the other thing you see here, it's all the same. It doesn't matter what type of image you show the neural network, it's basically learning the same filters. So we make all the computer vision partitioners redundant because the neural networks are outperforming them. And if you think this is all very complicated, there's some good news for you, because someone of you has tried TensorFlow so far? Okay, it's damn complicated. I wouldn't recommend it. Because there you have to implement everything in linear algebra terms, but there's the so-called Keras framework, which sits on top of TensorFlow. And look at that. So this is a 10-layer neural network, and you don't see any math, no? So every line is just adding a layer. In Keras, activation function is also a layer, so there are seem to be more layers than they are really present. So there are 10 layers, 3 convolutional layers, and some output layers. And that's basically all. So that's the whole definition of your neural network without any line of mathematics. So you can train this neural network very easily on some images. Here you get 70% accuracy. So here this VAL stands for validation accuracy. So what you do in machine learning is you divide your training data into different parts. One part you use for training, and the other part you don't use for training, and you just assess how good the model is doing for new data. So that's why it's called validation accuracy. So it's 0.7, which is 70%, which is not very good, but I've only used less than 100 images. If I push this to 3,500 images, so 2,800 images for training and 674 for validation, I get a value of 99% already. And there are still more images left, so I have around 22,000 images which I could use. It's just a matter of compute power and it takes some time. But you see here just a 15-liner gives me that result, and I've copy-pasted this 15-liner from somewhere. I even haven't implemented it myself, so pretty easy. But one problem I told you is scaling. So it will take a long time, so there you have some options for scaling, okay? Who of you has used Apache Spark? Okay. Who of you has heard about Apache Spark? Okay. Apache Spark still holds the world record in sorting 1 petabyte of data, so it's a very, very cool technology in my opinion. Just a little refresher. So if you have only one process and you do machine learning, you eventually will crash because you will see an out-of-memory error. That's one of the biggest problems I have. So therefore, the idea is you have to scale. First of all, you scale to multiple processes on a multi-core cluster member, but then you scale to multiple cluster members. So that's one thing Apache Spark does, and then it relies on a distributed file system. So either in the era of CPU-bound problems, you have a switching fabric and some storage system. But if you have I/O bottlenecks, then you can still use HDFS, which just uses JBOTs, so just a bunch of disks which are attached to the machines, and they create a virtual file system for you. And the idea is if you have 10 disks, you get 10 times the read performance because all data is now read in parallel. So those are the two options you have, and Apache Spark makes use of that. And all your data in Apache Spark is then stored in a so-called RDD. So for the Java programmers, think of a RDD like a Java collection, which can span all the aggregated memory of a cluster. And if that's not sufficient, it can be spilled to disks. So it's a Java collection, which can have a size of all the aggregated hard drives of your cluster. And for you as a programmer, it doesn't matter because the API is the same, okay? And Apache Spark takes care about parallelizing. So this RDD, the API, is a bit complicated, so you have to use functional programming for interacting with it. Therefore, since Apache Spark 1.5, now we are at 2.3 already, there is a wrapper around the RDD, which is called DataFrame. So data frames you also have in languages like R and in Python, pandas, for example. It's pretty the same. It's just the object which somehow behaves like a database table. And against this object, you can either write relational queries using an API, or you can use ANSI 2003 compatible SQL queries, and you can also mix and match those. So that's now true for Scala, Java, Python, and R. And there's another more performant version of this. It's called DataSet, which works for Scala and for Java because it makes use of the type safety you have, and it's even faster. So in order to use a simple Keras model and scale it on Apache Spark, you just use, there are three options at the moment: SystemML, Deep Learning for J, and Watson Machine Learning. So this is now an example using SystemML. For the Spark programmers in here, if you want to interact with your Spark cluster, you have this famous Spark object. That's how your code makes use of Apache Spark. And this model, that's a Keras model. That's the one we have created before. And out of that, SystemML creates now a parallel version of the model. And the cool thing is it has a built-in optimizer. It's outperforming TensorFlow, by the way, because there's more than 11 years of IBM research in SystemML. And I think three years ago, we open-sourced it as Apache project. And I think since beginning of this year, it's a top-level Apache project, systemml.apache.org. And there are two levels of optimizers. So the high-level optimizers, so as you can see here, it boils down to linear algebra. So you have to express your neural networks as, or your machine learning algorithms as linear algebra. There is no way around that at the bottom. Of course, you don't have to do that, but eventually linear algebra has to be accelerated. So SystemML can dynamically rewrite your linear algebra code into a more performant plan because it takes into account statistics of data set sizes, of source data set sizes and intermediate data set sizes. And also, if you write really bad linear algebra code, it writes a better version of it. So in this example, if you take a matrix U times a matrix S, and each of those matrices has 1 terabyte of data, you will end up with 1 petabyte, with a 1 petabyte matrix. And SystemML thinks, oh, that was an idiot. I will just rewrite this code, and we are better off. And at a lower level, it can even take into account whether this particular atomic execution should be run on a CPU, on a GPU, or on a Spark cluster. And that's all dynamic, okay? And you see here it's really outperforming a lot of traditional frameworks. That's about System ML. So I haven't brought a demo about deep learning for J and what's an ML with me, but I'd just tell you it's basically more or less the same. So deep learning for J is also a deep learning framework where you normally express your model in Java. It's more or less on the level of Keras. It's maybe a bit more complicated, but it's just plain Java. But they also have a Keras importer. So you can import your Keras model into deep learning for J, and then you are in the Java world. You can run on a single machine, or you can run on an Apache Spark cluster. And the third runtime we support is what's the machine learning. That's a cloud service we have. So you can basically push your trained or untrained Keras model or TensorFlow model or whatever to what's the machine learning, and that gets scaled automatically on GPUs. Okay, so if you want to learn more about that, we are running a course on Coursera. This is free in audit mode, so you just say go to course and join or something, and then you either pay $79, you get a certificate, or you click on audit only, and then you get everything for free, but no certificate. That's the URL. And of course, if you are taking the course, you will meet me there, so I'm taking care of the forums. At the moment, around 2 hours per day. And we have some more stuff going on. We are creating a specialization on Coursera. So we have two courses now live. One is about AI, one is about data science, and the third one we are creating is called Advanced Machine Learning and Signal Processing. And if you take all those three plus a capstone, then you can you obtain a certificate from IBM. So that's the URL you can pre-register for those. So that's all the stuff you are doing if you know the stuff or if you want to know the stuff. Okay, that's the low level things you're doing. If you are not interested in how the black box works, we have black boxes for you. Okay, and just to give you an impression, this is Watson Assistant, which is more or less the same stuff what Alexa is doing. We have some data-centric services, so automated machine learning. We have natural language processing-related services, image processing-related services, speech-to-text, text-to-speech, language translation, document classifiers, and some other cool psychological services. So for example, personality insights, you just send text to that service and you get back a JSON object with a psychological profile of that person, and it works really nice. And you can try it for free. You just type into Google personality insights IBM demo and you get a little demo application. You take emails from a friend and then you put it there and you see the psychological profile.